should look at the lakes and nature, that they are sacred and they serve, they keep us alive and we need to serve them. There are a lot of interest around the world now in making our human laws more compatible with the laws of nature. What would happen, for instance, if British Petroleum could be sued by the Gulf of Mexico? I mean, just imagine, or the Athabasca River could claim damages from the energy industry up in the tar sands, or the lakes, the rivers and lakes around Chemical Valley and Sarnia and the area could claim their rights. This is not so far-fetched. There are countries in the world that have adopted the right to a healthy environment as part of their constitution. There are actually many countries in the world that are now including environmental rights in their constitutions, along with the notion of human rights. There's a lovely man named Cormac Cullinan who's written a book called Wild Law. He's a lawyer from South Africa. And he says that one day in the future, people will look back on our generation and they'll say, the way they treated the environment and other species is comparable to slavery. And that the way our generation looks back on former generations and sees, this terrible thing called slavery, cannot imagine how it could have existed and been lawful, people in future generations will not understand how we were able to not care for the wild, the wilderness and the nature around us. So under a commons regime, all activity, public and private, would come under strict public oversight and accountability. And it would operate within a mandate whose goals are the restoration and preservation of the waters of the basin, as well as water justice for all who live around it. And what we think we need, all of those of us living on or near these Great Lakes, in these many political jurisdictions, is a cohesive and common analysis of the crisis facing the lakes, a common narrative to guide us through this journey, and a common set of goals to unite us as we move forward. We also think we need basin-wide consistent laws, regulations, and definitions to protect and expand the existing public trust laws, and we have to demand eventually the supremacy of this framework over the current failing one. And when people say to me, well, you know, how would this work? Well, I can say to you that in Europe in 2000, they made an agreement to govern their watersheds on a watershed basis because all their watersheds crossed many political boundaries. And they realized they were not protecting their waters, and so they have governance models that see these watersheds as one basin that needs to have one governance, one set of laws and practices governing them. So I dream of a Great Lakes Basin Common Watershed Plan that encompasses watershed-wide planning and management, where we could come to common rules on toxic dumping, sewage waste, sustainable food production, groundwater mapping and protection, common plans to fight invasive species, and I think we need basin-wide bans on bunker oil, nuclear shipments, tar sands pipelines, fracking, water exports, including for bottled water, and ocean-going vessel access to the Great Lakes until these vessels can prove themselves to be safe in terms of their delivery or non-delivery of invasive species. Now, this would need the full cooperation, eventually, of all the jurisdictions around the lakes. And so people will say to me, you're dreaming in technicolor. But there's a thing called NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. There's another called the Canada-US Border Security Agreement. We gave up tremendous amounts of sovereignty in these agreements. In NAFTA, we lost control of our energy. That's why they're in the tar sands, because we've used up all our conventional oil and gas, it's all exported, and now we're having to go to the poisonous stuff to keep up with our NAFTA commitments, to keep that energy flowing south. If we can give up sovereignty for, you know, the business community, surely we can come together and put the needs of the Great Lakes Basin together for us all. Surely we can come to some common agreement to save the Great Lakes of North America. I felt this on the tour. We've had a fabulous tour and a fabulous different events in every city. This is just phase one of this campaign, but what we're feeling from people is that they deeply care. They really want to do something and aren't sure how to do it. They'll say, I'm not a professional scientist, I'm not an environmental group, I don't know what to do. And our statement is, if you care at all, you have every right. You have what we call the right to care, and you have further the responsibility to care and to take the next steps. We would love to see this as a full treaty one day, and Jim Olson, who's a wonderful public trust lawyer from Traverse City, Michigan, and I presented to the International Joint Commission in December, and we presented this notion, and I think we got some very good feedback from them at the time, and we have just found out that the Waterkeepers Alliance, which is the alliance of all the waterkeepers, baykeepers, riverkeepers, and so on, at a meeting in the United States, chaired by Senator Robert Kennedy Jr., came together and adopted this notion of the Great Lakes as a public trust and a commons, and are presenting this to the International Joint Commission. So this is an idea that people are excited about and feel they could come together on. What we're saying is, you may be fighting, a dam here, or a nuclear shipment here, or an invasive species here, or whatever, or a pollution there. But what are we doing together? Can we come together and see that this is all one fight, and that we have to have one common dream to protect these lakes, so that these aren't just separate fights, but part of a wonderful whole. Our starting point, however, is not with politicians. It's in the cities, towns, villages, hamlets, and farms that ring the Great Lakes, and the people who live on them and love them. And for us in Ontario, we have a wonderful opportunity coming up, and that's the pledge by the McGuinty government to hold public hearings on a new Great Lakes Protection Act. And we want that act to have vision, we want it to have soul, we want it to have depth, we want it to have
spirit.
We want it to be stronger, and we think this is something that we can come together on. And we're also hoping that people are going to start going to their local municipalities, and just like municipalities call themselves a blue community, they can call themselves community supporting the Great Lakes as a commons, a public trust, and a protected bioregion. So the purpose of this tour is to get communities around the lakes, as well as community and environmental groups that are already working on this, to come together through this narrative of the commons and strengthen people's cultural and visceral connections to the Great Lakes and promote this right to care. We need to build on the great work of countless national, state, provincial, community, First Nations groups that have toiled for decades to protect this jewel in our continent. We must commit to forge together a participatory process commensurate with the challenges of these mighty lakes and the communities, First Nations, and habitat that depend on them for life. The Great Lakes need great friends. In the end, we're their only hope. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask you just to sit on your feet for a couple of seconds more. We have a bit of a special presentation this evening. You all know the importance that the Leonard family has had in both the fight for Site 41, but also in this community. And we wanted to make an award to the Leonard family in honor of all their hard work the many decades. I've asked them to please come up here, Bev and Daryl and the rest of you. Can you come up to the front, please?
Great appreciation for the exemplary commitment and tireless leadership they have shown to protect the water and land for future generations in this community. This is the Community Defense Award is presented in respect, gratitude, and love to the Leonard family by their friends, neighbors, and allies for the tremendous contributions of the victory over Site 41. And it's dated Monday, May 28, 2012, signed by myself and the Council of Canadians. And when we stood on the site today, we stood with love and awe and respect for all of you and our fallen family member. And I can tell you his spirit was with us at the site today.
Well, some time ago in 1979, I moved into a tiny township at the bottom end, and I met the Leonards. And from that time on, we grew together. So I could have never thought that our relationship would have grown to what it became. The fact is, I didn't even know it had. I would just show up all the time. They would welcome me into their home in the middle of the night, or who knows. My wife would always say when I got home, "Where have you been?" Well, I was just over talking to Gord and Bev, or Gord and Bev and Daryl, or whatever. And she'd just shake her head. "Well, what do you talk about?" She said, "Well, we're at war." And so we strategize, and we teach each other, you know, what we're going to do. And of course, Gord and I had a bit of a pact. He would do some things, and I would do others, and we'd check back and forth. To lose Gord is very, very sad for me, because he represents what we all are. We care, and it's not about money, it's just about caring. And this was our community, and we were called NIMBYs, we were called radicals. We were called everything. But really, we are the backbone of the country. And we elect people, hopefully, that will represent us. And sometimes that goes adrift. And it's up to us to hold them up to what they should be doing for us. And I think Gord did that. Nobody can know how many phone calls this man made to politicians, to experts, and all this kind of stuff. Nobody can know that. I know it. Certainly Bev and Daryl know it. The plotting, the things that we did to make it all come together. And certainly the accomplishments of Site 41 falls on the shoulders of everybody. It wasn't on any one person. But certainly, you all want to remember that Gord played an incredible part in this. Never got mad, just, okay, what are we going to do tomorrow? How are we going to do this? And many people have passed on since we started to battle this. It's a great sadness that Gord passed on as well. It came as such a surprise. And so I want you just to really feel the presence of Gord and what he represents. And don't get mad at our politicians. Smile at them. Say, "Come on, you can do it. You can change your ways. You can actually speak up and speak your mind. Represent us, because that's what we want you to do." So on behalf of my family, my wife, and my kids, I just can't say enough to the friendship and the loss for the Leonard family.
On behalf of the Leonard family, Gord's dad was raised in the area, and his brothers live there also. So we're all together. And Daryl was a young lad at 15, and we're at a hearing, and he proved one of the hydrologists, or the biologists, I guess, very wrong. So that was a determination right there. So thank you very much. Very honored.
into a question and answer period. But since you're all standing, I have a question for you. You might have already discerned what it's going to be. I want to know who's going to protect the water.
We better all do it.
I'll try that again. I want to know who's going to protect the water.
We are!
Who's going to protect the water?
We are!
Who's going to protect the water?
We are!
Can I hear you in Sarnia? Sarnia, they want to know who's going to protect the water.
We are!
In Thunder Bay, they want to know who's going to protect the water.
We are!
Down in Toronto, they need water. Who's going to protect their water?
Toronto.
We are!
There you go.
So if you have a water jug, raise it high. And if you need one, let us know. So thank you. And so maybe just while Liz is shooting some pictures. Just some ideas of what you can put in on the drops. And so all of them have different messages. I support the Great Commons.